Hi, it's me, Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut. SpaceX is now better at landing their Falcon 9 rockets than I am at flying kites. But one question comes up often. Why do they land on a barge in the ocean sometimes and land on land other times? And sometimes we see that SpaceX doesn't even try to land the first stage at all. In order to answer these questions, we'll go through the variables that are at play and show you some examples using the industry standard Geostationary in a convertible. Wait, what? Yeah, this episode rules. 3, 2, 1. Watching a SpaceX rocket land is maybe the coolest thing to watch this day and age. If you're unfamiliar with what I'm even talking about, I suggest you check out my video, Why Throw Rockets Away? Or if you need an entry-level vocabulary of rockets, I suggest you start here with my series, A Beginner's Guide to Rocket Vocabulary. Now, we've seen SpaceX land their Falcon 9s on both their autonomous spaceport drone ship, or ASDS, and back on land at Kennedy Space Center at their landing pad LZ-1. Their two drone ships are the sizes of football fields and are cleverly named Of Course I Still Love You and Just Read the Instructions, which are nods to the science fiction book, The Player of Games. So what does determine where the Falcon 9 will land? Well, I'm glad you asked, because it's really quite simple. First, we take a Runge-Kunde integrator that will numerically integrate a system of differential equations from an initial vector state forward to an arbitrary moment in time. Then we derive your equations of motion for your vehicle. We need to take into account aero braking and some translational equations that are highly coupled, nonlinear, ordinary differential equations that require numerical routines. I don't know what any of this means. Why? My brain hurts just trying to read that sentence, let alone trying to do any of the complex math. So let's start with something we can all relate to first. Road trips! And to be more specific, road trips involving a tow truck pulling a car with two astronaut giraffes. You know, giraffe-stronauts. Normal stuff. Our two giraffe-stronauts are on a road trip from SpaceX's headquarters in Hawthorne, California, and they want to get to San Francisco, some 400 miles away. Now, because they don't have opposable thumbs, they can't operate a gas pump, duh, so they need to get there without filling up. With two giraffe-stronauts, the car gets 30 miles per gallon, meaning it can go 30 miles on 1 gallon of gas. And their car has a 10-gallon gas tank, giving them a range of 300 miles. If they bring any other giraffe-stronaut friends along, it hurts their fuel economy by 2 miles per gallon, due to their long, gangly necks. Unfortunately, the car can't get them there on its own, so one day they got smart and said, I know, let's tow our car part of the way there, and then we'll drive the rest of the way. Huzzah! So, they call up a tow truck, who shows up with a massive 40-gallon fuel tank. The tow truck on its own can get 10 miles per gallon, with a total range of 400 miles. But then, they realize when they put the car on it with the passengers in it, the gas mileage drops to just 4.5 miles per gallon, with any additional passenger decreasing it another 0.5 miles per gallon. So now, with the car and two giraffe-stronauts on board, the tow truck's range drops to just 180 miles. The tow truck driver says, okay, I'll take you 100 miles so you can get there and I can still get home. In doing so, the truck will chew through 22.2 gallons to deliver them the first 100 miles, leaving the truck with just 17.8 gallons to get home. And now that it's not towing the heavy car and goofy giraffe-stronauts, it gets 10 miles per gallon. And that's 178 miles in range, which is easily enough to get back home. Okay, let's add another giraffe-stronaut to this equation to make it a total of 3 in the car. The car's gas mileage will drop from 30 down to 28 miles per gallon for a range of 280 miles. So the tow truck driver sighs and says, okay, I'll take you 120 miles, but now at only 4 miles per gallon, I'll use 30 gallons of gas, leaving me with only 10 gallons left to get home. He looks at the map and sees it'll leave him hanging out somewhere near Beverly Hills, which isn't too bad of a place to hang out, and he's got a cousin that lives there, so he'll just hang out there until someone comes and picks him up. Duh. And lastly, what happens when we add one more giraffe-stronaut for a total of 4 in the car? Will they still make it to San Francisco? The car's gas mileage will drop from 28 miles per gallon to 26 miles per gallon for a range of only 260 miles. The tow truck will only be getting 3.5 miles per gallon, dropping its range to only 140 miles, just enough to get all 4 giraffe-stronauts to their destination. But in this case, we're going to leave the tow truck stranded way up near Bakersfield. Nobody makes it back from Bakersfield. Am I right? I mean, Bakersfield. So, do you see what we did here? By simply adding a few more giraffe-stronauts, we quickly altered the trips of both vehicles, drastically. In all of these examples, we were able to get the giraffe astronauts to San Francisco, but depending on how many of them there were, we were pushing the limits of how far the tow truck could go and if it could return.
I may have lost a lot of sleep thinking about this.
Our parallels here are the first stage of the Falcon 9 is like a tow truck, the second stage is like the car, and the giraffe astronauts are the payloads. So let's take a look at three actual SpaceX missions to see what it looks like in real life. On February 19th, 2017, SpaceX launched one of their Dragon cargo vehicles on top of a Falcon 9 to the International Space Station for mission CRS-10. The Dragon capsule weighed 4,200 kilograms. This meant there was plenty of margins left over for the first stage to turn around and return to Kennedy Space Center and land at their landing pad, LZ-1. On March 30th, 2017, SpaceX launched an SES communication satellite to geostationary transfer orbit on a Falcon 9 rocket for SES-10. Now this baby weighed nearly 5,300 kilograms, so it had only enough margin to land on the autonomous spaceport drone ship about 400 miles downrange. Lastly, on March 16th, 2017, SpaceX launched Echostar 23 on top of a fully expendable Falcon 9 to geostationary transfer orbit. The satellite weighs 5,500 kilograms, which pushes it just beyond what can be recovered. So just like rockets of the past, the first stage plummeted into the ocean after only 2 minutes and 40 seconds of use. To keep the price of the rocket down and to get the performance out of the vehicle, they strip it of its landing legs and grid fins, which looks just plain weird these days. I call it a naked Falcon 9. Just like our giraffe astronauts going to San Francisco, small changes in a payload can mean big changes in how far each vehicle can travel. Something to remember is the Falcon 9 first stage weighs a whole lot less on its descent without the second stage and payload on top of it. This means it requires a lot less fuel to land on its own than it would require if there's all that additional weight on top of it. People have also asked me, why don't they land the first stage in Africa or Europe? Their thinking is the rocket is traveling east. Doesn't that mean the first stage could just end up in Africa or Europe? Well, let's take another look at that map and see how far it actually is. Oh, we're just barely off the coast of Florida still. Notice that even an expendable first stage burns all of its fuel and it still crashes only a few hundred miles off the coast of Florida. A very, very long ways away from Europe or Africa. And most of all, landing on a boat, although it seems crazy to us humans, has proven to be a very achievable feat by a computer-controlled rocket. But all this should drill in why recovering and reusing a multi-million dollar fine piece of engineering is so important. It's a shame that the portion of the rocket that is the biggest and costs the most is completely done after less than 3 minutes of use. That's crazy. That's really expensive and it only gets used for just a little bit of time and then nothing happens. So I think that does it for why SpaceX sometimes lands the Falcon 9 on land, sometimes in the ocean on the barge, and other times it doesn't land at all. If you have any other questions or comments about this, leave them in the comments section below. Make sure and hit subscribe so you know when I make more fun, funny, and factual content. Also, a huge shout out to my Patreon supporters for helping make this and other Everyday Astronaut content possible. If you want to help contribute, please visit patreon.com/everydayastronaut. Thank you. Thanks to Declan Murphy of the awesome website flightclub.io for the amazing telemetry visuals. Thanks everybody, that does it for me. I'm Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut, bringing space down to Earth for everyday people.